When communities are strengthened and change is made, those stories are worth sharing. Today, we meet a filmmaker who works closely with diverse communities to make media that tells their story. Please welcome to Studio A Meridian Hills Pictures, Lance Kramer. Thank you for being here. You started Meridian Hills with your brother, is that right?
Yes.
And
yes.
Can you tell us about how that got started and what your aim was in starting the company?
Sure. We started Meridian Hill Pictures in 2010, formally, as far as when we took the trip down to DCRA to actually file the paperwork to make it something real. But
what does DCRA stand for?
The DC Consumer Regulatory Affairs Office,
wow.
Which is where everything official has to go through in order to become real in DC. But I guess in some ways it started much earlier because it really grew out of, I guess, kind of conversations that my brother and I and just playing that my brother and I had done with each other since we were really just young kids and, you know, had been playing with a video camera and trying to tell stories through whatever devices or, you know, avenues that we had since we were really just little kids. So we've always loved storytelling. We've always loved film and video.
And working together, apparently.
And, yeah, with some, you know, moments in between,
yeah,
where
sure.
We were fought as little kids. But for the most part, you know, it was just kind of this process of trying to figure out how we could bring that all together into something that allowed us to be the types of filmmakers that we wanted to be. And thankfully, we had some other experiences working with others that would inform, you know, what we ultimately decided to do with Meridian Hill Pictures.
You also have experience, I think, as a journalist and some other things that are sort of not quite exactly related to film, but maybe related to some of your mission-driven work. Can you tell us about how your other experiences outside of film have helped inform your film work?
Yeah, sure. I think that actually it was a big kind of light bulb, like aha, eureka moment when I realized that all these things that I had done that to me kind of made sense as just fitting together because they were part of my life experience, but I think other people realizing that those all helped me to become a better filmmaker. So my time teaching, my time working as a print journalist, experiences working as a bartender and a barista, at a coffee shop, just learning how to talk with lots of different kinds of people, experiences traveling, doing manual labor, fixing computers. I mean, all these things actually, when you got into the weeds of becoming a filmmaker, trying to be a good storyteller and relating with a lot of different types of people, and also just trying to run an organization, like you draw on so many different types of diverse skills that are required that I think, like, I don't feel like I've had an irrelevant, you know, life or work experience.
Yeah. It seems like the relationship between journalism and making documentary films anyway is quite self-evident almost because you're doing investigative work, you're, you know, teasing out stories and so on. What about some of those other things, like in terms of preparing to actually do the technical work of making a film?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, there's our approach to filmmaking is really this kind of fusion, I suppose, or meeting of, you know, filmmaking, journalism, education, and community organizing. And so those are the elements I feel like we try to bring to the table to make our projects, mm-hmm. you know, and the impact of those projects come to life. I think the technical aspects, I'll say a lot of those I've just either self-taught along the way, and some areas are really just weaknesses of my own, and that's where I've really appreciated the fact that film is such a collaborative medium that, you know, as we've been able to develop as filmmakers and develop our production company more, we've been able to have better resources and a better, you know, network or community to rely on other people that have been, you know, real experts.
So if you can't do it, somebody can who's in your...
Yeah, and I think that it's been really liberating to also realize that, you know, to try to think about what you can do best.
Yeah.
And then find others that have real kind of mastery and gifts in other areas and create a team.
You mentioned community organizing a second ago, and one of the ways that your work is described is as community media. Can you talk a little bit about what community media means and how community organizing as an activity sort of feeds that, or which comes first?
There's the tradition of community media that, you know, some would say has its, you know, early start in, you know, public access television and has kind of grown from the movement to create community media that started probably in the 70s, 60s and 70s. But I think that today it kind of has taken on a slightly different form in the sense that we have media all around us and in theory may even have access to creating media in a way that's so different from, you know, those early days of public access where it was just hard to get your hands on a camera.
Cameras are everywhere now.
They're everywhere, and we're in an era of almost hyper-documentation. That said, I think it would be easy to mistake the fact that everyone's stories are being told, and especially that everyone's stories are being told in a meaningful and impactful way. I think that actually a lot of times stories are misrepresented or pushed to the sidelines, and certain really critical perspectives don't make their way into the mainstream.
So there's still a role for the editor.
So yeah, and I think that also a lot of times just the understanding of how to really kind of take ownership over those tools and make something of your own is a skill set that's not necessarily been made available to, you know, all communities, especially underserved communities.
So let me say something and feed it back to you and see if I'm making sense. So,
sure.
So one of the purposes of community media is to take essentially a professional set of tools and apply them to the work of people who may not be professional storytellers, but their stories get told through your work.
Yeah, I think that that's fairly accurate, and I think that also one of the things that, you know, we've tried to, I guess, recognize as far as what our place is that, you know, we can facilitate the storytelling process sometimes, but that doesn't necessarily mean that our own story or our expertise even is really where the most interesting things are. I think oftentimes, I mean, in almost every case, the people who we're working with, the community members, are the ones who are the real expert storytellers because they've lived it, they've thought about it, they've faced all these kinds of challenges in their life, and it's a matter of just trying to help provide some framework or structure that they can express, you know, their worldview or their experiences
inside out.
Through.
Well, we have two clips, real short clips here. One is from The Donor. Mm-hmm. The other one is from Voices from Within. Two very different subjects, two very different film styles. Can you set those two clips up for us real briefly, and then we'll watch them and talk about them?
The Donor is a short film that we made a couple years ago, and it was a project where DC Shorts, a local film festival, put filmmakers together or created a short film competition where over the course of a weekend they matched local filmmakers with local storytellers who were part of the Speakeasy DC network. These were storytellers who had told some sort of true story on the live stage and had maybe performed it once, maybe performed it multiple times, and the idea was to take that medium of storytelling in a live setting, combine that with filmmakers, and see what would happen over the course of...
Great, kind of like The Moth, but with film.
Exactly, yeah. And we were the only team that was a documentary team, so I'll maybe let the clip speak for...
Okay, and then we'll roll right into Voices from Within, so give us a hint about that one.
Sure,
as well.
Voices from Within is a project that... my colleague Ellie Walton and her sister Joy Haynes directed, and my brother and I have co-produced. That is a participatory film project working with residents at St. Elizabeth's Hospital in Southeast DC. So it's been a project of really fusing that kind of collaboration between filmmakers and community members to create, you know, this type of kind of community or participatory media.
Terrific. So we have a compare and contrast opportunity
ahead
of us. Okay, let's watch.
Sure.
I successfully gave a sample at the fertility clinic. I found out that they had rejected me as a sperm donor, and it's basically because we were honest on the questionnaire and said that I was gay. It actually made me feel like I was sort of a powerless, like, gay teenager. That's what it kept reminding me of. And so I actually had to start the story there when I was first writing it, kind of from that perspective. As the story developed, I took that part out, and again, it's because, you know, these stories are shorter that we do, and so you can't include everything. We are so sorry, and we understand if you want to walk away from this, but would you consider coming to New York and trying another clinic? I'm surprised and so relieved. They want me to be part of their kids' life, and now The only one really left to convince is myself.
It's the first time, I think, in the history of St. Elizabeth's Hospital they've allowed cameras in and patients to be photographed. But they did, and we signed up, and we're doing it.
Working backwards, taking the voices from within first. So we saw a patient, I guess, or a resident holding a camera. Is any of that footage from cameras that were manipulated or operated by residents?
Yeah, the film is really a kind of hybrid of material that was filmed by the residents in, you know, what we've either called kind of a video diary format or material that they've filmed effectively through their own kind of point of view throughout the facility, because they're basically not, you know, permitted to leave the facility. And then also filming that Ellie and her sister and other collaborators have, professional filmmakers have also filmed it. And I think that we've tried to almost create this, with the finished film, a sense of real fluidity as you move between those two, so that you kind of have this almost 360 view of the story.
Do the lines blur between who's shooting what?
I think, you know, you kind of hope if we're successful at a certain point that you stop thinking about, you know, what, you know, whose camera is this, and you're really just kind of lost in the story.
Wow.
I think that's what you hope that you kind of can achieve.
And you're always aware that some of that is really, really literally from within the belly of the institution, which is very powerful.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, it's sometimes what the... And it's different with every project, but I think when you put a camera in someone's hands, it allows them to feel a real, and I hope a genuine, sense of ownership in that process. And then that impacts your relationship, it impacts their trust in you, it impacts the type of access you have to their story or to their life. So, you know, it's something that has really facilitated a kind of, you know, storytelling that we've strived for.
So with fading back to the donor for a minute, so in that case you had essentially a professional narrator, right,
as and
source material. So in the shot on the street, that was his sort of performance voice that we were hearing?
Yeah, what's happening there is that we had this kind of unique challenge, which was that, you know, we had 2 or 3 days to make a film and a documentary about the storyteller, or really about his story, and all the other teams had recruited actors and wrote a script and found locations to effectively recreate these stories that the storytellers had told. We didn't want to do that because we didn't even know how to do that because we're documentary filmmakers. So we thought it might be interesting to have the story of our film be about how he had arrived at translating his life experience into this, you know, monologue that he was performing. And so the film is really about his storytelling process. So when he's walking on the street, he's actually walking from his apartment to the Navy Memorial downtown to perform his story. And then you're actually hearing
so the sound is kind of bringing us there, and then
so it's just playing with 2 different moments in time.
Fantastic. What are some of the inherent challenges of community-based media or this kind of participatory filmmaking?
There's a lot. I was talking about access and trust and relationships. Mm-hmm. I think that's kind of first and foremost what we spend a lot of time focusing on, because I think if we fall short in those areas, you don't have a project. You may not have a project that it just may not exist at all, or it can't actually have the type of impact that you'd like. I think that... certainly distribution is always a challenge, mm-hmm. because the types of frameworks that are in place to share media, unfortunately at the moment, aren't as conducive to the type of work that, you know, we spend so much time on that we think is so important. And it's incredibly easy to have something get lost in the mix in YouTube or just in the interwebs.
Well, I was going to ask, so is there a market? There's obviously, I think what I'm hearing is there's not a ready-made market for everything that you might.
There's a lot of aspects of what we do that take on a real kind of do-it-yourself, DIY type of approach, and particularly with distribution, we wind up not just being a film production company, but also kind of being a grassroots distribution facility entity, in the sense that we're, I feel like, all the time we're organizing our own screenings. You know, we've invested in our own pop-up screening equipment so that pretty much we can turn any space, outdoors or indoors, into a place to convene and watch and engage with these types of stories. And, you know, you kind of have to think outside the box about that. And what's been interesting is that I think as far as impact is concerned, a lot of times the type of impact that we've been able to accomplish through something we've set up on our own in an untraditional screening space has far exceeded what I, you know, could, what you think, you know, maybe a viral video could accomplish.
Yeah, or even a festival kind of setting. We have another clip, very interesting clip from a film called Shauna's Hope, right? Can you tell us about how this, a little bit about how this film came to be, and then we'll watch the clip.
Sure. That film originated through, it's also directed by my colleague Ellie, and produced the film. It's a story of a young woman who lived in Delaware and died tragically in a car accident several years ago. And her parents, and she had elected to be a organ donor. Unfortunately, due to some effectively bureaucratic issues after her death, like her wishes were not able to become fulfilled, and so she actually didn't become an organ donor. Mm-hmm. And that launched her parents and her kind of family and community into this almost form of activism to change the policies in the state of Delaware such that that could never happen again. And so the story kind of starts as a story of kind of activism as a reaction to this tragic moment, but then it also then I hope kind of deals with these more universal themes of overcoming grief and, you know, finding peace, you know, even amidst, you know, awful
and
tragedy.
Making the film becomes a part of the activism.
Exactly, right? Exactly.
Okay. Great, let's watch.
This poem is meant to illustrate a day I remember vaguely. I often have small epiphanies in which from one small event I realize the enormity or the meaning of other larger events. The surface of the water on that day was a clear, reflective piece of glass. As soon as I dipped my feet in the water, as I'm apt to do, the ripples cascaded out.
An organ and tissue donor can help 50 to 100 different patients, just that one donor. And there's over 100,000 people around the country who are waiting. The need is huge, and one person can truly help so many people just through this one simple act of giving.
When you were approached to do this subject, had you already had a connection to the issue, or was the connection developed through meeting the Kaufmans and working with them on this?
It was the latter.
Yeah.
I didn't have a connection. I mean, to be frank, I'm not an organ donor myself. And so, and I was very clear with, you know, them that, why are you kind of interested in having us work on this? That's kind of where I'm coming from.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, they were interested in the way that we, you know, the way that we've kind of synthesized stories and worked with people. And I think that it was a good creative challenge as well, because, you know, it put me in a place of how to, you know, honestly tell a story about an issue that I actually hadn't thought about much myself, but I realized how profoundly it had impacted this family and really the whole community, and I know a lot of others in the country. So it was a good challenge for me, because it wasn't the type of thing where, you know, I'm just, you know, giving a lecture on something that I feel like I need to communicate, but really just trying to learn and listen.
Terrific. We have some questions from our studio audience, I believe, and you're the first.
Hello. I heard that in 2012 you participated in Silver Hacks, a collaboration between documentary filmmakers and cutting-edge technologies. I was wondering, how did the advancement in technologies affect the documentary landscape?
So a lot of aspects of what we do are really lo-fi. They're, in a sense, it's a lot of times when we're working in an edit, we start with just note cards and we're manipulating things on a whiteboard. And so there's this aspect to what we do that's fairly lo-fi, but at the same time, I think we've been really interested in how at this particular moment that we're in, there's so much that's possible that wasn't possible in those early days of public television. And I think that what we were trying to explore with that hackathon back at Silver Docs a couple years ago was how the internet can facilitate a kind of nonlinear type of storytelling where, you know, we're all familiar with telling a story, you know, in 30 minutes or 90 minutes where you sit down and watch it beginning to end. But because of the way the internet's designed, and particularly things like HTML5 that allow you to do much more with video, you can also kind of create these environments where you can kind of navigate through a story and almost, say, choose your own adventure and kind of make sense of it through your own curiosity, and that some stories might be more conducive to that. So we were really just trying to play with that. It's still kind of the Wild West. There's, you know, I think everyone's just scratching the surface of what's possible, but we've been interested in kind of dipping our toes in that water as well.
Great. Do we have another question?
Yes.
Why do you think that DC has the potential to be a hub for nonfiction filmmaking?
You know, I'm from this area. I was born in DC and I grew up in Bethesda, Maryland. My family's been here for four generations. So I have a bit of a biased opinion in one sense, and just this from the sense that this is my home and I care a lot about this place. And I think that what I've also grown to really love and appreciate about the city is the fact that you have so many people in this city that are highly educated, that are change makers who are seeking to make the world a better place, and that that's combined with all these amazing institutions, public, private, all across the board in the media space that are kind of a pipeline towards getting stories and information out to the world. And that then that's also combined with these incredible needs and challenges that the city and the residents of the city are facing, with a lot of resources at the same time that are federal and local to make change happen. And the rest of the country and the rest of the world also seems to always be focused on what's happening in DC. So there's always kind of this stage and kind of interest in what's happening here. So I just feel like when you put all that together, it's just this kind of really interesting recipe for you know, excellence in nonfiction media. And there's a lot of great institutions that are really trying to push that forward as well. You know, Docs in Progress, Women in Film and Video, DC Film Office. There's been a lot of energy, especially I think the last 5, 6, 7 years, to figure out how to solidify or advance, you know, DC's identity and place, like, in the broader film community.
Great. Another question, please. Yes, sir.
Yes. Meridian Hill Pictures is a DC-based company. Have you ever thought of branching out to other cities or communities, creating new films and opportunities in other parts of the United States?
It's a good question. Not particularly, in the sense that, you know, we're at the end of the day, we're fairly small. We're, you know, less than 10 people. We're a small team. I think that part of our, I guess, DNA as an organization is to be, you know, locally focused and rooted in a particular space and a particular place. So I think that, you know, I don't necessarily have aspirations of having a satellite office or satellite studio somewhere else. I think that we'll kind of always see our home here in the DC area. And it may be that a project leads us to work somewhere else at a certain period of time. I think that's something we've started to talk about. But it would be hard to imagine, you know, leaving this area. And I think that also I'm just really respectful of the fact that in other parts of the country, even other parts of this area or region, there's others that know their community well and that there should be a place for them. So I feel like, you know, the more we kind of recognize how to be good, you know, stewards or good neighbors and really involved in our particular area, then there's kind of space for almost like an infinitesimal number of you know, storytellers, filmmakers, production companies, rather than feeling like we need to franchise, you know, out.
It's like having a local paper, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I think we have time for one more student question, if there is one. Yes.
I wanted to know what your favorite documentary was.
It's a hard question, and there's so many. But there's a film I love called Crisis Inside a Presidential Commitment. That's about it's an old Verite film by a filmmaker Robert Drew back in the 60s that looked at how the president and his brother RFK and the governor in Alabama dealt with a particular crisis that had emerged during the civil rights movement. And it's this just really profound, beautiful, observational film that is told through these three perspectives of the attorney general, the president, and the governor of a effectively segregationist state. And there's kind of equity given to all of those perspectives as they're all three wrestling with this challenge of a black student enrolling at the university for the first time. And so I just think that the way that they set up that structure and how important of a document that is in history and witness to that moment has always inspired me. So,
terrific. Can you tell us briefly about your upcoming project? I know it's a long-range project you've been working on for about 4 years called Green Core.
Sure. It's a film about individuals who have been impacted by a green job trading program that was created through the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. And it's really a story of their experience kind of walking on this journey, you know, amidst the recession and, you know, the economic decline or collapse that we've had over the last 5 years of experiencing unemployment, having this kind of transformative and ambitious job training experience, introduction to new skills and new kind of potential for their employment, and then what their journey has been like, you know, moving forward, trying to transition that short-term training into something long-term and sustainable. So, you know, we've been working on the film for 4 years. It's been a real wild ride.
I'm sure the story is changing as you're making it.
Yeah, we didn't know, you know, where this would go, but I think we've just, you know, really fallen in love with the story and all the people who have, you know, agreed to participate and allow us, you know, into their lives. And we hope it'll, you know, do a lot of good.
Do you see the end yet?
We're approaching, I think, the end of the film. Yeah. I mean, obviously, everyone's lives
continue. No, I mean, it's just the
we're hoping that by the end of this
story,
by the end of this year, to have the film released and shared.
Fantastic. So, well, Lance Kramer, this has been a delightful afternoon. Thank you so much for being with us today in Studio A.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching.